If you're looking for a great tool to manage your projects in, then Projectum xPM got you covered. Right now we are logged on to Projectum xPM, and from here I can quickly go in and click on the new button at the very top. It's from here you can enter a name. So let's say the name of this project is the Demo 500 project. I hit the save button and already now the project is in the system. You can then also from here select between different project types, so you can categorize it as a small project or perhaps a large project. And depending on your type of project, you will see that different things change at the very top. So all these tabs will appear or disappear depending on what you're asked to do as a project manager. So let's keep it as a large project. Maybe write, this is about showing what Projectum xPM can do for project managers. That could be the project description. We could then also maybe link it to a sponsor within our company. So maybe the sponsor is Matilde. So I'm gonna search for her. And she didn't appear. So I'm gonna select another one. And from here we can perhaps go in and select a person. That could be myself, maybe I'm the sponsor, like this. And we also have ideas that we can link the project back to. So essentially, if an idea appeared before the project, then those two can be linked. So we can always track the idea on its own, but also the project on its own. Then further down here, we can set up the scheduling timeline for the project. So essentially, these are two date fields. So if we say the start date should be today, and the project has to complete no later than, let's say, August 31st, like this. So these are the corner flags that we establish before we allow the project manager to create any tasks within the project. So next up here, we can also assess the project using different ranking mechanisms, like how is it on strategic impact from high to low. It could be change impact assessment. It could be risk profile. This could be done differently, but this is how it looks out of the box in Projectum xPM. Then we can also set in expected benefits. So if you had something that we can measure in terms of value, then it could be, let's say, 1 million euros that we expect this project to bring to our company within the next 3 years or however we want to set it up. Then we can also tag the project to a portfolio it belongs to. That could be the tech portfolio of 25. It could be a certain program, so a group of projects. So maybe it's project or program X1. And then we have business drivers that are typically more static ways of tagging your project against typical business drivers such as growth, mandatory projects, differentiation projects, improvement projects, or whatever we want to call them. But more dynamically, we can also connect a project to the strategy of the company. So here we use OKRs, objectives and key results, so that one project can be connected directly back to a part of our company strategy. So we can see what initiatives are providing value towards executing our strategy. Beyond this, let's move into the timeline right now, because this is the place where many project managers often start the journey when it comes to establishing the plan. So here we have three ways of doing it right now. One is starting a new project based on a template. So these are the building blocks that you can provide as admins, and then all project managers can then use these templates. We can also start with AI. And we also have the ability to start from scratch. So if we do that for this demo right now, you basically just get a planning grid like this with nothing in it. And the journey would then start by you going in and saying, create task here. Maybe that's phase one. Then we do a task A, task B, and task C. And we can then quickly set aside days or duration for each of these by saying this is not 30 days, it's 20 days. That's one way of doing it, like in Excel, but we could also use the mouse to quickly do it this way instead. And in this case, I'm using a face up here as the container for all the tasks below the face. So typically you would like to go in and then select all these tasks and move them underneath the face. We can also have you create milestones easily. So milestone one, perhaps, you can set those to a duration of 0 days. So they show up like a milestone. And if I zoom out a little bit right here, you can then see the start and the finished date flags that came from the first two date fields we entered. This means that if we start task B here, task C there, maybe the milestone here, we can see that we are within our boundaries. But the moment we start too early, things light up at the very top, so we can see you have a problem in terms of respecting the approved planning dates that our steering group has provided us with. Also, if we are delayed, you will also see things lighting up as red at the very top. Another thing we can do here, if I just zoom in a little bit to maybe weeks. If we take task A and connect it to task B like this, we now have a task dependency established. Finish to start is the type in this case, but it also means that if we look at the left side here, we can see that this task has a potential scheduling challenge. And basically it's because this one should start when this one is completed. And right now those two are not in sync. To fix this, of course, task A could be finished earlier, then the problem goes away. But if it is delayed, then we can move task B instead like this, and then the problem is also gone. That's a very loose way of doing things, which we have seen many people ask for over the last couple of years. So that's why we have this option enabled. But there is also another option, which is more traditional when it comes to planning tools, which is called hard links. And basically that means that if this one moves, it forces task B to move as well. So of course we have that part. Now, going back again to the overview here, we can also create a full version of this project, so the schedule at least. So up here we have something called versions. Let's say this is one version, and now you want to create a version 2. So we create a version, which means it's a full copy of the tasks. So now we are working with the version 2 of the plan. Let's say we then move this one to here, and this one to there, and this one to here. Then we can do version 3, perhaps. Like this. So now we have three versions of the same plan, and we can then flip back and forth between the versions if we want to, going back to the first one. And whatever we decide on to go with, we can then click on and then hit the publish button right here and say it's version 2 I'm going to use, so let's publish that one. So there will always be one published version of your plan, which is what the rest of the organization will see. Before we move completely away from the tasks, we can also add resources. So clicking on task A, I can add myself as a resource. We can also add Simon and say 50 hours to me, and Simon gets 30 hours. So now we have the two of us, the same task that we're working on. So if I click on the heat map symbol up here, we can then see that Peter has these hours over this time period and Simon has these. You can also zoom into weeks or even days, and you can also see where there are potential problems, because if you mouse over, you can see that Simon is not completely overbooked in this project, but he might have other project tasks he's working on outside my project plan. That's why it's flagged as red in this case. So that's the resourcing part. Then as a project manager, most likely you're also asked to manage your risks. So if I click on risks at the top here, we offer a very dynamic drag and drop friendly risk matrix that can be configured as well. And the way it works is basically that we can either use AI to create our risks, but we can also click on new risks and just create risk 1, 2, 3, which is already connected to the project. And then I can go in and add a risk description, mitigation steps, set an impact of high, maybe a probability is 40%, maybe a due date for when this might occur, and then save and close. And the moment we do that, the risk is then stored in the risk log register. And at the very top, it's also visualized where the risk is in the heat map or in the risk matrix. If I move it from here to here, you will see that it changes immediately. So it is possible to just drag and drop the way it should look as a project manager. Beyond this, we can also go to the financials. And of course, as a project manager, we need to somehow establish a budget. Either a resource budget, but then also a financial budget most often, or quite often. So right now we have a financial grid that can be very long like this, with categorizations of CapEx and OPEX, and also detailed cost categories below CapEx. It's all up to the administrators of this tool to establish what should be the approach when it comes to managing our financials. In this case, I can actually start in years and say in 2025, we also need one more year, which is 2026. So now we have 2 years. And in 25, we're going to set aside maybe 400,000 on materials. And in 2026, we're going to set aside 300,000. So 700 in total. And as you can see, the money is rolling up to the top level. So you have a quick overview on all the money that is being allocated to this project. Now, if we then click on quarters, I can then see that in 26, it has automatically distributed the money across all the quarters equally, and in months as well. This is basically the same as saying you can plan top down and then later on go in and in details adjust whether or not it should be 25,000 here and then maybe it should be 30,000 here. So that's the financials part. Another thing we can do, of course, is to manage the statusing of the project. So let's imagine that we now save this. And the project now at the front page has a total budget of 680,000 euros. There are expected benefits. Therefore, we also have an ROI. And we are still in the initiating stage. But up here, you can also click and progress to the next stage. The only thing that is required right now, governance-wise, is that we have filled in the description field right here. So that's why I can move ahead. We can also move from business case to the gate decision in just a second, because we have also filled in the sponsor, the start date, the finish date. So all these are checklists that are linked to the governance or the body of how you want to manage your projects in the company. So what you will then do now, if you want to save a full copy of this and also create a status, is to click on KPI status like this, click on new status report, select the date, and then I can go in and say things are going great. I can also have AI do a summary for me. I can go down here and say on the cost side, we are green, or maybe we are not, maybe we are in red. And then if we are in red, we are guided on what to do next. So the system says you should go in and explain how you're going to fix it. You can then write something here. Scope might be green, schedule is green, resources green, quality is green. And we can also see the last time we did a status, what were the numbers back then. So when I save this, we drop a full one-liner right here of the current state. So we can see that once the project was in business case, 680,000 was the budget, cost was red, scope was green, and so forth. And these numbers are then shown at the starting page right here. So the last status update is the one you see right here, which clearly shows that you need help, but also that you're writing that things are going great. So maybe your summary needs to be adjusted a little bit before you report on this to your managers. As a final thing, at the very top up here, we also have a summary provided by AI. That's a native part of the platform. So you can see that this project is now in the business case stage. It's about creating a Projectum xPM demo for project managers. Latest status date is also here. We can see start date, end date, progression, if there was any progression on the task, and so on and so forth. So this is actually one way of seeing AI come to life, which is a completely native part of the platform as a whole. Final note is that as a project manager, you most likely also need to manage documents. And documents are often stored in team sites, SharePoint sites, OneDrive sites. This is something we connect to natively in Projectum xPM. So if you have the ability or the need to create a team, you can just click the button right here, and this will automatically create a corresponding SharePoint site and or Teams channel. So when I click save right now, then we automatically get a SharePoint link down here, which means that if I go to Documents, it opens up an iframe showing exactly what goes on in the SharePoint site for this specific project. So as a project manager, I can stay in Projectum xPM, upload my files, create folders, do lots of things that you would normally do in SharePoint or Teams, but all the project team members can stay inside Microsoft Teams and access the exact same folders and files. So that's the document management part of the tool. So these were just some of the features Projectum xPM offers to you as a project manager when you want to manage your projects. If you want to learn more, check out our other videos.